Hear me. Great. Hopefully everyone online can hear me and we're already in the room. So my name is Allison Kupsco. I'm an assistant professor here in the Department of Environmental Health Sciences. I'm going to give you a little bit of a talk today on tips and tricks for scientific grant figures. This is something that I've thought a lot about over the last few years of my career, and it's something I really enjoy doing. And so I'm kind of excited to get to share what I've learned over the years with all of you. But before we begin, I really think I need to emphasize that the pictures that I'm going to be showing throughout are mostly taken from my own grants and grants that I've worked on with collaborators. And as such, they really are our intellectual property. I'm not showing any that are from grants that are currently under review because those would be confidential. But you know, the images here are really not for distribution or commercial use. They really are our own. Others as well are taken directly from biorender.com, and we have a license to use biorender images for educational purposes, but these cannot be used for commercial purposes either. And so just as a disclaimer there before we start. And really, I think I should preface by saying that absolutely anyone can make great figures. It just takes a lot of time and effort to get good at, and it's something that I've put a lot of time and effort into. And so my goal today is really to share what I've learned for all that time and effort with all of you so that you can go ahead and more quickly and easily apply those same concepts to your figures as you make them for your grants. And many of these things may be things that you already know. Some of them are quite obvious to some people, but others might be new information. And so, I'm happy to share. And I'm also happy at the end to start a discussion on what other kind of techniques people use that they think might be useful. I'm also still learning in this process. Also, I think I should give a little bit of information about me. Disclaimer, I'm not a graphic designer. I'm not a scientific illustrator. I'm an assistant professor that just likes making figures. I'm an environmental epidemiologist and toxicologist with a focus on epigenetic markers and mechanisms of disease. And so a lot of my grants follow the model kind of at the bottom here. We start with an environmental exposure. This goes us on to a molecular mediator and an eventual health outcome. And so you'll be seeing a lot of this model throughout the talk, but a lot of these concepts can be adapted towards different types of grants. I also pretty much exclusively apply for NIH grants. And so if there are specific figure regulations for things like EPA grants or NSF grants, I will not be addressing those here. I also want to give a background on software and platforms. I primarily use biorender.com, which is one that we've started using a lot more in the department. Most of the images that you'll see in the presentation today are from them. However, this is not intended to be a plug. They're not paying any salary to me. It's just something that I enjoy using. It does require a subscription for a publication license, but it's not exorbitant. You could also do a lot of these things in PowerPoint. It's better at aligning objects, in my opinion, but there's a lot of other challenges. Draw.io is a software that Happy introduced me to many years ago. That's great for making diagrams for free. And I just found one called Mind the Graph, which is very similar to BioRender, but I haven't used it. So if anyone plays with that, let me know how it is. Okay, so the outline for today's talk, I want to kind of break this up into two overall parts. First is the types of figures that I often include in grants and why, and what we want to convey with those figures, but then also just some tips for making our figures as visually appealing and as impactful as possible, as well as going into some like practical considerations for figures that we all need to pay attention to. So for types of figures, when you're considering what figures to put in your grant, you have to think of the goals, right? And the goal of every application is to get funded, and that's very clear. But the way that figures can help us towards that goal is important and varied, and many figures can reach many of these goals. So one might be to convey significance or innovation, right? You can show the reviewers why your science is important rather than just telling them in text. You can also use them to highlight particularly innovative aspects of your proposal, right? If you have something that you think is really going to make your proposal stand out, put it in a figure because the reviewers are going to see that first when they look at the page. Others could be to clarify complex methods or ideas, right? Sometimes we use rather complicated statistical designs, rather complicated experimental designs, and we can use figures to more graphically illustrate those things. Especially the ones that might be more difficult to describe in text. A third and somewhat obvious one is to create visual interest, right? An application stands out when it has a figure that looks good. And when reviewers are reviewing 30 applications, you want your application to stand out, right? It makes the application more memorable, but it also caters to different type of learners. Not everyone can obtain and gain the most information through reading. A lot of us are visual learners. And then finally, the last one, which kind of goes in hand with these, is to convey key information, right? Figures really help us convey our information quickly. In comparison to text, which might take you a full few minutes to read a page, you can look at a figure and instantly get the information that you need. It also allows us to repeat critical points. So there are some things in applications that, you know, you don't want to be a broken record over, but there are some that the reviewers need to hear over and over. And in that case, a figure could be really helpful. So the types of figures that I put in grants, the first of which I'm going to start with is conceptual diagrams. I think that these are really important for grants. The next would be an aims diagram, and these can go hand in hand, but they don't have to. The third would be an experimental design or a cohort design, basically just a graphical overview of the study design, and that's always really helpful. The fourth is a workflow, like a statistical workflow, team organizational diagrams, and prelim data. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through each of these individually and give examples of what I've done in particular grants and why I think that they were effective. So the first of which is conceptual diagrams. I always include at least one of these in my application. And honestly, this is usually what I start with before I even start writing the application, is just to get kind of like your ideas on paper, right? The goal is to kind of quickly convey your hypotheses and your scientific premise and add visual interest to the application. I actually usually start with one of these at the beginning of the significance section so that the reviewers know the significance before they even have to start reading. It also creates visual interest and emphasizes your significance. So for example, in this image here, we're seeing those kind of three main steps, metals exposures to DNA methylation to cardiometabolic risk. And instead of just having a 1, 2, 3 points, we can clearly see that the use of the lines here and the arrows can convey the different effects of different metals on our DNA methylation phenotype. And that was really one of the primary goals of this application, was to look at metal mixtures and how these metal mixtures might be influencing our health. Other kind of questions to ask yourself when you're designing these conceptual diagrams is not only how this is going to enhance it, but what are the key points? You can't include all of your information from your application in this diagram, right? It would be way too overwhelming. And so you want to make sure that you're picking up on those key points. And finally, the last one is, who is your audience? You should think about this when you write any grant, right? We always tailor our grants to a specific study section. You should tailor your figures towards that study section too. Unfortunately, we don't always get to choose what study section we go to, but generally you'll have an idea of where your grant's going to go. And you can say, okay, I know that the majority of the people in the study section are clinicians, so I'm going to focus more on the environmental side of things here to show them, you know, how important the environment is. We also have a little bit more freedom here than an AIMS diagram, right? I can show the cardiometabolic tissues that I'm interested in. I can zoom in, and I can also kind of highlight hypotheses that might not be as important or not directly tested within our aims. However, you can also include the aims in your conceptual diagrams as well. So this diagram here on the left, you know, not only are we showing the different concepts, but we're also able to show the aims quite clearly in kind of a three-pronged approach. And so this diagram accomplishes both of those goals. We're showing the conceptual design of our study, but also showing, you know, how our aims are designed. And then this last diagram kind of on the other side is a bit more biologically focused, and I think really highlights the biological hypothesis that we have in contrast to the AIDS hypothesis. In this grant, where we did show the more kind of biological hypothesis diagram, we did have a very separate and detailed AIDS diagram. And so these two things needed to go hand in hand in order to convey the information. Conceptual diagrams can do more than just highlight your overall scientific premise. They can also be used to highlight key ideas that might be important for your the point that you're making. So in this project, we were doing a multi-omics analysis, looking at different levels of the omic development from DNA methylation to RNA expression, protein expression, and the metabolome. And our kind of important point that we wanted to take away here was that we were going from a more kind of stable heritable function to a dynamic function. And this diagram does a really nice job of showing that connection. We can also use them to highlight more complex ideas. So in this grant, we were also using these omics to create a sort of multi-omic fingerprint. And so this is one of the major innovations of the grant. And so this figure actually went into the innovation section where we were combining DNA methylation and metabolomics into a single measure and what we called a fingerprint. Okay, so the next sort of important, I guess, level of importance diagram that I include in my grants are AIMS diagrams. You want to clearly and concisely convey your AIMS, but you can also include more detail here than you would include in like a conceptual diagram that's more intended to be a figure, right? You want to make sure that your AIMS are following a nice linear path and that you're able to convey that they're not interdependent on one another, right? Which we know is a key fact for these NIH grants. And you also can use them to highlight what information might be available and what information might be added in the application. So for this, this diagram here, the information that was available was our exposures and our outcomes, but for the K99 and R00 portion of the grant, we added our intermediate information, and that was what I used in the shading. And you can see that very clearly here in this figure. But these figures can get kind of as complex as you want. This is one that Howie made for a grant that we put in together that he did a very nice job on, which was able to show the linear flow of the AIMS from both a human population study and an in vitro study, but showing them together in the way that they can align very clearly, right? And we can clearly see that these sets of AIMS are highly complementary and measure many of the same things while still being distinct. And that's one of the kind of important points of this diagram, is you want to show how connected these AIMS are with each other, but also that they are distinct. This also allowed us to include more information on the methods. So, you know, what exact air pollution measures were we using, what exact transcriptomics measures were we using, and things like that. And, you know, it's a larger diagram. It took up a lot of space, but it was worth it to include it in the application. The next diagram that I usually include would be a study design diagram. This includes study design for both a human population study, but also an animal or an experimental study. This is good to show both the timeline and the progression of the cohort you're working with. I work mostly with prospective studies, and so we collect data over many, many years, and we can show that timeline with clearly with study design diagram. This also allows us to highlight what information is collected at which time point. And I would recommend that in these sorts of situations, you really use color to distinguish which types of information are being added when. So for example, this is a rather simple version of the figure where BMI and bioimpedance was measured at many time points throughout childhood, always in purple, whereas the other types of measures are in different colors. Sometimes this information can be also included in a table. With a table, this allows us to highlight what might already be existing plus what might be added, but we can use color in a very similar way here to emphasize our exposures, our mediators, and our outcomes. And this can really get kind of as complex as you want it to get. This is a diagram that we made for the Superfund research program, where what we were doing was drawing from two cohorts to create a third. And we did this by using the blocks around the measures from the different visits and the arrows that connect them. We also added different outcomes, metals, DNA methylation, and water metals at different time points, and used color and also the boldness of the font to highlight which items were being added when, so that the reviewer could quickly look at this and say, oh, look, there are four time points of metals because I see four metal boxes, right? Four yellow boxes. And that's something that's very quick and clear to convey without spending too much time reading all the text. The next one I'm not going to spend too much time on is workflow and methods diagrams. These diagrams, I think most of us are used to making at this point, but you want to make sure that you're not really overloading them with too many details. It's always good to be as linear as possible, just so that the reviewers can quickly follow it. Now we made this one as well, and I really like that the different types of analyses are color-coded once again to show that, you know, really we have broken this up into different ways of thinking. Similar concepts can be taken when we're talking about figures for preliminary data. We're all used to including preliminary data in our applications. Basically a prerequisite, but you don't want to just copy and paste those figures from your paper, because oftentimes those will have way too much information on them, or they'll have acronyms or other points that you haven't had a chance to explain yet in your grant. And you want the reviewers to take a look at that figure without having to read the entire page and take away the gist of the application. And so you really only want to keep the most relevant information. And you know, in a paper, we would never include something like a figure title, because this would be, you know, just distracting and unnecessary and not professional. But in a grant, it can be useful to include a figure title, because in this case, you know, it gives the reviewers a quick, clear idea of what they're looking at. The next one that I've started including in more grants are diagrams for complex PI or MPI or co-I teams. This is one that I made for an RPPR progress report, but I have made others for other grants. Really what the goal of this is to emphasize the organizational structure of the team, but also to show how we all kind of depend on each other. In this diagram, we can see that all of the work that is being done at the different institutions is stemming from the central box of Columbia, where we're doing all of the central processing. And then other work is being done at Weill Cornell or Texas Biomed. And it shows that we're all kind of working together and who is responsible for what. And something like this is probably too big to put in the main body of the approach of your application, but it's something that you could include in if you have to do a multi-PI plan, for example. Okay, so that pretty much covers the types of figures and what I'm trying to convey, which each of those types of figures. But next I want to go into like what makes a figure visually appealing and what makes a figure impactful. But does anyone have anything that they wanted to ask or add or say about types of figures before I move on to like the nitty gritty?
Yeah.
All right, sounds good. So for me, I think one of the most important parts of figures is color. Color theory is actually real. It's not a joke. It's something that has been around for a long time now, right? And I don't think I have to say this, but I'm going to hammer it home because it makes it easy, is that, you know, red, orange, yellow, these are warm colors, these are angry colors, right? We often use them to denote bad things, in contrast to blue, green, and purple, which are cooler colors and happy colors. This picture of the gut I took directly from BioRender. They made that figure showing a healthy gut and a diseased gut. And you can see very clearly the red background and the red gut are extremely effective in showing that that is bad, even though that figure itself is exactly the same, right? The image is exactly the same, but the way that the picture is highlighted is what denotes it as something that's bad. You know, you can also use colors to contrast these important factors. So in the bottom side here, we have a T cell killing a cancer cell, green, good, red, bad, very clearly easy to see. I also do a lot of work with oxidative stress, and I almost always make my oxidative stress components red or orange or yellow.
Can I see a comment from online?
Yeah.
Steve Childred says red, green color blindness of potential reviewers is also an issue.
Yes, it is. And I'm going to address color blindness a little bit later on, but you should always double check your colors before you go to publish. And there are other ways of denoting differences besides color. So for example, to Steve's point, right, with this gut here, we're not only using the color to denote the changes, right? That is something that is very clear for me, who's not colorblind, to see, but for those that might be, the kind of glowing halo that's added around the gut can also provide that contrast. And so there are a lot of other ways to highlight items besides using color. And I have specific examples that go back and forth from black and white, so you can see that in action later on. Additionally, I would just kind of as a general rule recommend staying away from bright primary colors for all of your figures. It's just a bit jarring to look at the exposure mediator outcome there. It's very clear, you see it right away, but it's perhaps not something that you were pleasantly surprised by. You might mix primary and secondary colors. I have the kind of color wheel up there at the top where red plus blue make purple. Red and yellow make orange. If you've ever painted before, this is something that you should probably be familiar with. And I like to play with those relationships in my figures. So you can see with this one at the bottom here that I showed early on, the exposures themselves are blue and the outcomes are red, and they mix together to make the purple in the middle. So I'm going to give a few examples of colors from one figure and how changing the colors can really drastically change your what your eye is drawn to in the figure and what how the figure is seen. So this example here, we're just seeing on how an M0 macrophage can go differentiate into M1 or M2. These kind of like pink and yellow is a bit too bright and too annoying. I would stay away from that. I would also be careful about using too many colors unless the goal is to highlight that each of these cells is doing something different. So now it's just a little bit too distracting and too busy to have all of these colors together, unless, again, the goal is to differentiate the different cells. Another way of doing it might be to play with the shade of the different macrophages, but we can see in this bottom one and that unless the goal is to highlight the M1 cells, what you've done here is actually done yourself a disservice because the M0 and the M2 cells are now too faded. And so you're not really seeing them as well as you should be in comparison to the M1 cells. And so, you know, my preference would be to kind of, if the goal is to look at them all evenly and create something that's visually appealing and something that's balanced, because the point of the figure is balance, would be to use colors that are kind of all within the same shade and the same tint. Another effective use of color is to use gradients to denote change. So gradients can be used to go from yellow to red, for example, in the progression of a disease, or they could be used in going from blue to purple if perhaps we're just indicating change over time. And these changes over time can be, you know, they don't have to be something that is denoted with a thick arrow, but they can be something that's denoted with color instead. The other use of color that I take a lot of use for in my grants would be using it to convey important factors. As I mentioned, we used the same colors to denote the to denote DNA methylation here, for example, is always green, metals is always yellow, metabolomics is always purple. And using those colors to differentiate them allows the reviewer to clearly see them. Alternatively, you could stay consistent with your colors for the same types of measures. So in the figure on the right, we have the color for the arsenic, the exposure, the mediator, and outcome all the same, whereas the other parts of the figure, which are important but perhaps not as much, are in a different set of colors. If you don't know where to begin in selecting color palettes, there are a lot of kind of places out there that are available. Schemecolor.com is one of the ones that was recommended to me by one of my postdocs. They have thousands of different color palettes. For making figures just in general, I really like this package called GGSci and R, which takes color schemes and color palettes from a lot of the top journals like New England Journal of Medicine, Nature Publishing Groups, AAAS, and makes them into color palettes that you can easily implement in ggplot2. And they're all very nice and they go well together. And then BioRender itself has a bunch of presets that are available for preset colors that are kind of naturally more subdued and not as overwhelming as picking your colors directly from the default in PowerPoint. But as Steve brought up, and this is something that's extremely important, you need to make sure that your figure works in black and white as well. And you know, this isn't only true for those of individuals that might be colorblind, but also for reviewers that are going to be printing applications. So for example, here's a figure that I made where you can see, okay, we're trying to highlight the mitochondria, something in red, but when that becomes black and white, it's totally indistinguishable from the rest of the outcomes. In contrast, if we use this glow feature, then we can see that that's still distinguishable even when the figure is in black and white. Another example of this is kind of just the different elements of figures. So maybe not necessarily something that you need to highlight very clearly, but you want to make sure that your figures are still easy to see. So in this example here, we have a yellow chromosome and a yellow metabolite on a blue background. And because those are contrasting colors, we can see them very clearly in color. But once we turn them to black and white, the chromosome kind of fades into the background. And so changing that to a dark blue allows it to still be quite visible on a black and white background. And so BioRender actually has the option to preview your images in black and white before you export them, but other options include, you know, just printing the figure out on your personal computer and seeing what it looks like and making sure that it's okay. Okay, so the next part of figures that I think is really important is design and what goes into a good figure design. I think, you know, for grants, one of the most important parts is to highlight the key information that you're looking to share. One great way of doing this for molecular studies is to use callouts. We then use these kind of magnifications or callouts to emphasize the tissues or the interior components of what we're interested in from a regular perspective. So this woman on the bottom, we can see has a call out of the pancreas. Whereas in this other study, we were looking at the placenta and how that might be changed during pregnancy. And so using these call outs allows us to really take us from the general to the specific and highlight that specific information. You should also make sure that you kind of gray out or make transparent the less important information, right? The whole woman is not important in this figure, right? So she is gray. But another kind of example of that is this picture that I already showed, where we didn't have RNA or protein expression available in this study, but there's still important components of this pathway. And so we have them there, but they're faded out. And so we can see then that there are other components, but it doesn't necessarily matter because we have things on either end. And that's what this figure is able to do by highlighting the key information in comparison to the information that is less important. I also use a lot of boxes, as you may have noticed, to identify the most important factors in the grant. That usually is my exposures, my mediators, and my outcomes, but it could be intermediates as well, for example, the AIM number or something like that. Layering these boxes on top of each other and on top of images and interspersed actually creates depth. And this depth creates visual interest in a figure. It allows there to be some sort of, I guess, like pseudo 3D nature to your figure rather than having it be totally one-dimensional. I would recommend, though, choosing one shape for the application and being consistent on that sizing and dimensions. You can see I like this kind of rounded square, but a square is fine too. I generally stay away from circles just because they create a lot of wasted space when you add text to them. Another important part of your design is the amount of detail. I would recommend definitely focusing on clarity rather than detail, and you have to allow that white space within the figure to work in your advantage. Your figures are giving your reviewers a chance to take a break of their eyes, right? And we pack these applications with detail and with text and try and make everything as small as possible, but really people need a break because they're reading a lot of them. For example, in this kind of fake graph that I made on the left, we're highlighting a lot of things. We want to make sure that we get all the information in there, but is that information really necessary? And the one on the right, in this case, would be much more effective at highlighting the important points. And the same can be said for when you're doing these kind of study design diagrams. You want to make sure that you're not overloading these figures with too much information. This is just an example that I started with a basic template from BioBender and added all of this information that I personally would include in a study. But maybe not all of this is information that needs to be included in your first pass. You could separate this out relatively easily into a figure and a table, and it would be just as impactful and easier for someone to read. The next part, and this is something that seems kind of nitpicky, but for me, I always find to be as like one of my pet peeves, is using icons with similar levels of detail. So for example, here we have an extremely detailed bed indicating child sleep efficiency, and then a somewhat two-dimensional, simplistic indication of a school indicating academic performance. And it's a little bit jarring to look at because the level of detail in both of them is so difficult. However, if you were to replace that bed with something that has a similar level of detail as the school, we can see already how much better that looks. I have another example here with cheese and with mice. 2D mouse, 3D cheese does not look as appealing as 3D mouse, 3D cheese. I'm right.
I can't tell the difference.
I saw many of those.
It's really, it's just a little bit grating. And so while it's easy sometimes to pull images from.
You say your bad examples are still good. I saw.
Well, you know, one thing at a time, right? And so I think this is, it's easier, obviously, to just pull the first image that you find on the internet, but it's in your best interest to try and find icons that have a similar level of detail. And that can sometimes be tricky, right? If you have really like leaned into the 3D and you have to find 3D images for all of your things, you may want to reconsider, but it's something that can be really helpful. I also, if you may have noticed, use a lot of pictures and images to create visual interest in my applications. These images really should be, you know, thoughtful in the way that you're using them. Which are you choosing to represent? What is the most important part that you want to represent that you want the reviewers to take away, right? So for example, this diagram on the right here, we have a heart and we have a pancreas, and that's really just because we're focusing on cardiovascular disease and diabetes. So that's very clear for a lot of clinicians. Yes, heart, pancreas, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, right? But we can use other sorts of images just to create visual interest. So this figure on the left, where we have exposures and outcomes to biological pathways and integrated networks, it's not absolutely necessary for me to have that brain or that network figure there, right? Ultimately, that actually takes up more space than it would if I had the words alone. But using those images allows the reviewer to quickly and easily say, you know, okay, this is their hypothesis and this is what they're going to do. And layering the little circles, which are supposed to represent extracellular vesicles, for those of you that might not realize that I do a lot of work on extracellular vesicles, creates a visual depth to the figure that wouldn't be there otherwise. So finding images and icons and adding them to your figures, it can take up a lot of extra space, right? As I mentioned, adding that brain may not have been necessary. And in this figure here, which I showed earlier, I have an image that's associated with each aim and with the outcome. And even though that makes the margins of my figures bigger, including that extra white space makes it easier for the reviewers to see. And so you don't want to overlap your images directly on top of your boxes to try and fit everything in as tightly as possible, because that just makes it look cluttered and makes it difficult to see. You have to use the white space around those boxes and allow the reviewers to kind of have that breath as they read your application. And BioRender has, I mean, thousands of images, many of which are editable, which can change colors and can be used. And so this is just an example of the workspace. But there are other places as well to find icons for figures. Some of you might not be aware that PowerPoint now has an icon feature, the like updated version from the last couple of years has an icon feature that you can search for these icons that can be changed in color. They also have stickers and illustrations and stock images for your use. And then one of my students, Will, brought to my attention this website called Noun Project, which is a similar function, but is just on the web. So these are also places you can find. They won't be as nicely detailed as the ones that you might get from BioRender, but they're still very effective. And the last part, I think that's the last part of this section is really working with effective fonts. So most of us write our grants in Arial, which is a sans serif font. And so I would recommend sticking to a sans serif font for your figures as well, because combining serif and sans serif fonts can look kind of jarring, which is what I have in this example here. It can be just a little bit messier looking and a little bit more difficult to read. I don't necessarily think you need to use Arial for literally everything in your application, but it can be nice to just kind of stay within that vein. It's also better to use something that is either bolded or italicized to highlight text differences. And I'm adding this because this is a mistake that I make constantly all the time and always need to go back and double check, but be consistent with your capitalization, right? So in the top box, we can see that every word is capitalized. In the bottom box, we can see that only the first word is capitalized. When you're writing quickly, this is something that's easy to do, but if you do it everywhere, it can look messy. And so I always have to go back and fix myself and presentations too. So this is probably not consistent at all either. All right, so the last kind of important thing to keep in mind when designing figures is the organization. You wanna make sure that you order your processes logically, left to right, up to down, circular for processes. And while this seems sort of obvious, right, to us, because we do often think in these ways, sometimes when you're just sort of working creatively, it doesn't happen. So this picture here is one for the first version of the grant that I put together, where we're going from air pollution to placental stress, and then it kind of goes out in different ways to the brain or to neurodevelopment. And it's actually kind of messy and difficult for people to see. And someone said to me, like, this is not super clear. Can we make it a line? I was like, oh, shoot, yeah, we can make it a line. And so you can see that once I put it into a linear pattern, it's just a much clearer trajectory. And so oftentimes you have to iterate over many versions of a figure, and your first organizational output might not be what you end up with in the end. You can also use other sorts of designs, like a triangular design, if you have something that's branching out into two different processes, or from a top to the bottom, I like both of those designs. And then kind of when you are doing these layouts, this is actually something that was provided to me by BioRender. It wasn't something I had thought too much about, but different arrows can indicate different processes. For those of us that are biologists, the kind of perpendicular arrows for activation versus inhibition is, I think, like pretty ingrained at this point, but thinking about other types of arrows and what those arrows might be indicating to your reviewers is also important, right? These kind of like thick faded arrows can indicate movement and a much greater progression than like a thin arrow would. And so, you know, be conscientious when you put these arrows. You don't want to just kind of like throw them in willy-nilly. You want to think about really what they're conveying. And if you don't know where to start, use a template. BioRender has dozens of templates. PowerPoint has dozens of templates. You can look online for examples. And so, you know, a lot of these have been thought about by real graphic designers. And so they can be also a really good place to start. The somewhat last section is placing figures throughout the grant and where and how do I place these figures. The first is in the significance section. As I mentioned, I will always start with a conceptual diagram, but you can also include preliminary data, other conceptual diagrams. I usually include at least one conceptual diagram in the innovation. And then in the approach, I'll start with my aims in the overall, followed by like a study design, prelim data, statistical, and workflow, and all of that kind of goes in there. But really what you should kind of aim for, if you can, is to have at least one figure per page, because that really breaks up the flow of the text. It makes it a lot easier to see. And honestly, you take a little bit of a like breath of fresh air when you go and you see that it's not a full page of text. You can also change up your layouts to create visual interest and keep the eye from getting fatigued. So if you have a kind of landscape style figure on one page, maybe consider putting a portrait style on the next page. And then the last point is to be consistent throughout the application. So you want to be consistent with the level of detail that you're including in your graphics, be consistent with color schemes, right? If you have decided that yellow is metal, so make yellow metals throughout the application. Don't change it from figure to figure. And those things are just, you know, sometimes again, you're working on one figure on one day, and then a month later, you're working on the next figure. It's easy to forget, but altogether, it makes a really big difference. Okay, so just to wrap us up. Some key practical considerations. You want to export your figures at a minimum of 300 DPI, a resolution of 300. I usually use pings for graphics and PDFs for line arts because they resize quite easily without looking blurry. And then font size, I spend a lot of time resizing my figures. And so I don't work with a particular font size when I make the figure, but once you have it in the application, you want to make sure that that font size corresponds to a minimum of 9-point Arial. You don't want to go too much smaller than that, otherwise people are going to be squinting at your application. So just to kind of wrap us up, making figures is really a learning process. It's always helpful to show your figures to your colleagues for feedback. I often include a figure when I share my aims, just so it kind of gives people an idea not only of what your aims are, but okay, maybe if something was missing from your aims and it wasn't clear, this is what you actually meant to say, right? Always some trial and error when making figures. I'll go through often multiple iterations of a figure before I land on the final one. And so, you know, with that, there's a lot of people to acknowledge because I worked on these grants with a lot of hard work from a lot of amazing colleagues that put a lot of thought into these ideas and a lot of work into looking at my figures as well. So many thanks to everyone that's been involved, as well as to the P30 for inviting me to give this talk and the Superfund program, which a lot of these figures were also taken from. And with that, honestly, I'm happy to answer any questions, but I'm also open if people have ideas for software or for techniques that they use or things like that. So thank you. Right. Oh, sorry. Matt, Howie, you know what?
That's okay. Wonderful presentation. Thank you. I learned quite a lot. I noticed that most of your AIMS figures went from top to the bottom, except your last one went from right to left. Do you have thoughts on, like, is there a reason for top to bottom versus right to left?
I think, like, for me, I personally just function better in top to bottom, and that's really go in that direction. But sometimes it has to do with space. So sometimes the right, one of the reasons sometimes I do try and avoid right to left figures is you get stuck with this sort of awkward size on the page where you end up with a thin strip of text next to it. And so it's really difficult to read. So you either have to resize the figure so that it's giant and takes up the whole page, or that it's tiny and takes up half the page. And so that's one of the other reasons I often go top to bottom. But I do think I also just see visually top to bottom better. So.
Just as like a small point on that, one of your top to bottom figures also used icons that drew your eye from left to right. So it was like structured in the top to bottom, but like had this nice visual with the like the air pollution stacks, and then you ended up with the body on the other side. So you have that like way of looking, but like with the sizing of the
Thank you for noting. I honestly started out by just making things that I liked, and putting this presentation together was actually a bit of a challenge because a lot of the things that the decisions that I make are not conscious. I think it was really helpful for me to think about them as well. And honestly, a lot of these figures now are about a year or so old because the grant life cycle timeline is so long. I've changed my style slightly in the last year or two. I now use more squared boxes rather than rounded boxes. And if that's just my decision, yes, I think it is. But I think your figure style will evolve over time. So Howie, did you have a question?
Yeah, we spent a lot of time thinking about like how to refine our figures and what are the reasons to use figures, but what the other way around? Like, have you like thought about what situations should we not use a figure and maybe it's detrimental? Like, has anyone ever thought about this? Because I don't.
I go back and forth sometimes between tables and figures.
It's definitely one consideration. Yeah, I guess I just something that popped up in my head.
I mean, I think you want to make sure that your text is clear no matter what, right? Like, you want your text to be on point all the time anyway, whether you have a figure or not. And so I think in that case, as long as you've been over 30 drafts with your co-op, figures will be okay.
We have some questions online.
Yeah.
Does Columbia offer any basic 101 courses on using BioRender? Does anybody know?
No, BioRender itself does have a lot of tutorial videos online. If you want to scroll through their materials, there's a lot there. Honestly, though, it's pretty straightforward. I feel like, honestly, it's a lot easier than using PowerPoint. You just kind of search for what you need, drag and drop, and move things around. But it's a good question.
And then Robbie asks if there's a BioRender EHS license available.
So for me, it says talking to a rep, but it's very inexpensive, to be honest. To be honest, we are looking whether we can save some money, but I think it's really a few dollars per month. It's not, I don't know, do you remember?
I think it's like $9 per month for an individual account, which you could, and I didn't say this, but you could share it. I didn't say that. But there's also like a 5-person lab account that you can get for like $30 a month or something. It's not that much more expensive to.
And we have a longer question from Swati. I don't know if you want to ask out loud or go ahead.
Do you have recommendations for design reach to follow for accessible design, keeping in mind disability and justice? So for those of us waiting and just answer us, I prefer Sarah title stands as any guide. I think keeping in mind disability justice is absolutely something that you should do. Again, I focus a lot on color, and that's something that personally is important for me, but is something that you need to consider in all of your grants. I think that keeping in mind when you make your figures, this isn't something I went over because I think this is something that's up to the researcher, but is equally as important, is keeping in mind that you're being inclusive in your figures and being allowing for diversity and allowing for inclusion is something that's extremely important. That's why I often either try to introduce diversity or just kind of make my figures black outlines just to be as inclusive as possible. And that's something to keep in mind. On the topic of mixed serif sans serif, like serif title sans serif body text. I haven't played with that myself. I'd have to see how it looked. I would be careful with using too many texts, definitely. But if you are being extremely consistent, then it's probably fine. I think honestly, one of the major takeaways that I'd like to say is that consistency is key throughout your figures and throughout your grants. So.
Can I ask something? You mentioned before, wait, sometimes you need to decide whether there are you're using tables or figures. Something that I noticed from my experience with reviewers is that if you ever study design, and you don't have all the measurements at all. This is a cohort study. You have the measurements are not consistent at time points. A table highlights that. In the tables, you see the empty cells, and reviewers are more likely to pick out on that and say, oh, but you are measuring the chemicals only one time or only two times while you have seven time points. That's a weakness. When in a figure, it gets more diluted. I mean, it's not so easy to spot visually.
Yeah.
That is something really I considered when I'm picking a table or a figure, because if I have all the measurements at all time points, a table highlights that the table becomes all.
Yeah, that's good.
That's something that I noticed, that sometimes I use the wrong thing and the reviewers were incredibly nasty.
Wow, okay, good to know. Yeah, thanks, Dr. I'll pay attention to that too. It's true that you can be a little bit more hand wavy with your figures. You can see that one or two of the ones that I showed, we went directly from birth to 5 years in the same gap, we went from the second to third trimester. And so obviously that doesn't happen, but it makes it very nice to just look at. So sometimes being a little hand wavy is good.
I'm wondering if, like a lot of times when I make particularly figures that are like more scientific, like preliminary results, I use a lot of color, these colors of dimension. And so that gets harder in black and white, right? I'm wondering, does BioRender have ways to kind of visualize what things look like for somebody who has, let's say, red, green, colorblind there?
So they don't do different types of colorblind. There are, I believe, software online where you can copy and paste your figure into and they will show you what different types of colorblind look like, but they do just do pure black and white. But I will say too, and you know, I'm not really presenting a lot of data in the figures that I put in grants except for prelim figures, but using a mixture of shape and color can kind of alleviate a little bit of that. So that's something that I actually often do, you know, for example, in a simple example would be a correlation plot and using a gradient, right, to highlight a positive versus a negative correlation. You could use a up arrow and a down arrow, which would highlight the same information. You could use both next to each other, would highlight the same information, but be accessible to those that might also be colorblind. So there's a lot of ways to think about it. And I have to be honest, my first thoughts about that many, many years ago were because I didn't want to pay color figure charges for journals like 20 years ago. But now, you know, as I move on in my career and think more about it, it's something that could be really impactful.
Another question as well. So I'm in the process of starting my first NIH grant. You just mentioned one figure per page. That's way more than I would have put into one of the Canadian grants.
Okay.
It's kind of like looking for other thoughts, like that's a lot of space now devoted to figures. Yeah. I just want to get but I get that reviewers would find it hard as well, right?
I mean, one page of text is unbearable. Maybe I don't want to read that grant. I'm already upset. When you see one page that is only text, especially if there is no room between paragraphs, I hate you. and if I hate you, we think that you are scored based on rational decisions. People score based on feelings. So you better keep the feelings up, because if the feeling is that I can't read this, it's not going to go well.
And that kind of goes to, like, let's say you put a teeny tiny figure, right, in the corner of your page just to make it nice. But you could also, increase the spacing between your paragraphs, right? You know, sometimes we do like 6-point font in between our paragraphs just to make everything blend. But make an 8-point font, for example, and that looks a little bit nicer. Or highlight your titles with both the bold and an underline or something to break up the text a little bit more. So it's not just, have more sections rather than one long section, that type of thing, to create more of a visual interest than just a single page.
we use color in the text as well? Like sometimes I've used like, let's say blue lettering for the headers and that kind of.
Can we? Are we allowed?
I think so. I think there are the guys, but it's not typical. And I would suggest not to stand out. When you see a grant that doesn't look like the normal grant, usually people don't use color. What I see is that sometimes they are shaded, like the four bigger, the highest level, like in significance, innovation. I mean, those are sometimes people use like blue shading or light gray shading behind the text, like in the third line. I haven't seen colors. If you use colors, that would be. And we use colors that are not bright, something that is a little subdued.
Right.
The other thing that is important to your question is that the average review, when you assemble your application, you will see it's probably something between 200 pages and 500 pages. The average reviewer gets 10 to 12 applications, and usually they keep them like 4 to 8 weeks to read them. So it's a lot. So you better make their life easy.
Right.
I'm not saying it needs to be a children's book, but
right.
I mean, not, it needs to be pleasant.
We also have a great comment in the chat from a comms person suggesting that we ask ourselves two things. If our visual is communicating what we are trying to communicate, which is an extremely good point, and you should, I think, ask yourself that before and after you make every figure. But also, does your eye know where to go or does it get confused? And yeah, that's also a really good point. And that's why I think it's also helpful to give your figures to other people, because sometimes, just like with a regular grant, when you've been writing it and you've read it a million times, it looks great to you. But when someone fresh sees it, it could look quite different. So yeah, thank you. Was there another unread one? No, I think that's good. Well, thank you all for your attention. I appreciate everyone coming out and good luck figure making.